recipe that I want to share with you now is a beautiful version of a fish pie. It's thrifty and it's delicious, and I call it sweet pea fish pie. It's so good. It's heroing most of the ingredients from over there, the freezer. Things like vegetables are amazing in the freezer. I'm using spinach and peas and then fish. You can have it sitting there in the freezer waiting for you to cook something delicious with it. And there's many methods of cooking, especially when it's in a nice sauce or it's kind of baked, where frozen fish really can be fantastic. And as long as you get something nice and sustainable, you're laughing. So I have 300 grams of salmon and 300 grams of white fish. And if you look in the freezer aisles, you'll see some really good frozen fish. So in a pan, we go. And I'll cover that with 500 millilitres of milk, and I'll just simmer it to poach it until it flakes, so about 10 minutes. So this recipe's great at kind of swapping in different fish and making do and stretching fish a long way. Now, what I wanna do is show you how I make the most delicious mashed potato topping. I've got a kilo of potatoes that are peeled, just cut into chunks, boiling away for about 15 minutes. And then we're gonna use the second freezer ingredient, and that's 400 grams of frozen peas, okay? So just put them in there for a minute, happy days. These can go back in the freezer. That's the great thing about the freezer, isn't it? Just use what you need straight back in there. I'll drain it straight away. So over we go to the sink. So in this pan here, we're gonna make the most amazing cheesy sauce, full of the good stuff. I've got two onions, finely chopped, and two carrots, finely chopped, just in a little bit of olive oil. And I've let those slowly fry for like 10 minutes just to soften. So what I want to do now is to thicken the sauce. 60 grams of flour goes into that pan, and then mustard, another store cupboard ingredient. I like a good teaspoon. It's not hot, you just get a nice flavor from it. Stir it in. And then the liquid that we need is going to come from there, the poaching liquor. So I'll just take a little spoon, nick a little bit of that milk, just steal a little bit of that liquid like that and mix it around. So the fish has already flavoured the milk, which is all going to add to the flavour of the whole dish. As it absorbs the milk, then we get the spoon and take a bit more. And it makes the most delicious sauce. You can see it thickening up and it smells amazing already. The colour from the mustard is very, very good. And that last little bit of milk, like that. You can see here, if I show you the fish, can you see how lovely this salmon will just poach? Look, it's just falling apart. Really nice, gorgeous. I absolutely love good quality frozen fish. It's handy. Can you see how lovely this sauce looks? It's really, really good. So, the third frozen ingredient is frozen spinach. 100 grams go in. And again, frozen spinach is so brilliant to have in the freezer. It's particularly good for soups, in the stews for the last kind of half an hour, really nice. Amazing in curries, amazing in curries. And if you think about it, the amount of spinach in this bag would be like a pillowcase worth, right? Because it's all been blanched and it's been squashed into these little kind of pellets. And if you just put it straight in a hot sauce like this, it starts to melt and then you get spinach flavored sauce, which is going to be absolutely gorgeous. So look, the nice thing about this recipe is you can use whatever fish you can get your hands on, fresh or frozen, but I just think frozen fish is brilliant if you use it in the right way. And in a dish like this, it's the perfect way. Now, a little optional extra to give it real delicious flavour, cheese. So a nice little grating of cheddar cheese I think is really, really good, but literally use what you've got to hand. You can use it almost like a seasoning. So sort of 40, 50 grams. Look at that. So next up, lemon juice. Just half a lemon going in there, I think is delicious. So if you haven't got lemon, that's fine. But just a little squeeze of lemon like that just lifts the whole story. I love it. So the sauce is now done. I'll have a little taste. Mmm, delicious, so good. A little salt and a nice little hit of pepper, but good to check your seasoning. You can see here with the fish, we can just break it up into chunks like that, and we can just get that in. And of course, if you had different fish, that's fine. You can duck and dive, and I think these times, that's what it's about, right? Being flexible, being agile in your recipes. And, you know, you want to kind of be able to do good cooking no matter what. So look, that looks incredible. Let's do the topping, because I think this is one of the best bits. And actually, as far as my kids are concerned, right, it's all about the potatoes and the peas. So let's get a masher. Let's get a nice knob of butter. A pinch of salt and pepper, and then have a good old mash up. Just keep rattling away, and then we'll put it on top. I mean, for me, for all the parents up and down the country, always trying to get more veggies into their kids. You know, this is a good way, but it's also blooming good for the adults too. So what I tend to do is just take a little bit of our topping and lay it on the top like this. I don't throw it all on top because you don't want to displace all the lovely sauce. So sort of evenly distribute the potato here. So look, here we go. That colour. It's just brilliant. And once you've done that, just use the spoon just to sort of move it around and sort of go up the edges. Look at that. So you can make it rough and ready. You can fork it up. You can do nice little turns. Because as this cooks, it's gonna go golden and blippy and bubbling, and that lovely sauce is gonna find its way out. It's gonna be extraordinary, and I can prove it to you because I did one earlier. Right, check this out. Come on. look at that. Crispy on the top, all the juices kind of baking their way out. Let's get that down. Let's have a little portion up. Come on, get in there. Oh, look at that. Beautiful chunks of fish. Absolutely delicious. Really simple, good, honest grub. You know, stuff that makes you really happy. Come on, let's have a little try. So good. Mmm. You would never know that was frozen fish. It's so good. It's a clever, delicious, thrifty dish. In the freezer, the peas, spinach and the fish. You know, give it an hour or so and you can have this. Joy. I'm going to show you the most delicious recipe for homemade soup. A beautiful bowl of steaming vegetable soup with cracked pasta in there. It's a kind of minestrone. My family absolutely love it. I'm going to show you how to make a very, very quick homemade pesto that is pungent and full of flavour. The two together are sublime. So we've got good recipes here, but I'm going to introduce you to your best friend in the kitchen, the freezer. And I really want to tell you the benefits of using frozen veggies, having them in your freezer, and allowing you to really make delicious dishes full of all the good stuff. First up, let's get the veggies. So let's have a little look what we've got here. This is a bag of sofrito. All the supermarkets are selling bags of chopped up carrot, onion, celery, stuff like that. I've actually got some lasagna here. This is fresh lasagna that you can actually freeze as well. But of course you can use dried pasta in this dish. I'll put that to one side. I've got frozen peas, a classic. I've got some frozen stock made from the leftover carcass of roast dinner, roast chicken dinner. Just put it in a pan, cover it with water, any little bits of sort of veggies, some herbs, boil it up for a couple of hours, and then put it into bags, and you can freeze it for another day. Great for risottos and soups. And then I've got some frozen broccoli here. I've got some broad beans here. I'm gonna put the chicken stock to one side. In a pan, let's make a beautiful hearty soup. Put that on a heat. We're gonna go in with some olive oil here, like that. I'm going to go in with the sofrito. Sometimes supermarkets call it chef's base as well, but essentially it's the same thing. So we're gonna defrost that and start to fry it off. And we wanna get that caramelization, that sweetness of flavor coming out of the veggies. So mix in your sofrito. We've got our veggies sort of sitting here ready and raring to go, so they can sit to one side. So while this sofrito starts to fry and caramelize, I want to talk to you about pesto. Now, look, the jarred pesto that you get in the supermarkets. Super convenient. Like, you get all kinds of different pestos. So 10 out of 10 for convenience. If I want to make something that's truly jaw-droppingly delicious, then I want to show you how utterly simple pesto can be. So, this is 100 grams of basil, and I'm gonna throw it in there with the stalks, everything, okay? I'm gonna go in with a handful of nuts. These happen to be pine nuts, right? But it could be almonds, it could be hazelnuts, right? It could be pistachios. I'm gonna use one piece of Parmesan here. I'm gonna use a knife to take the rind off, and I'll tell you about this later. And I'm just gonna break up the Parmesan like that into the machine. One clove of garlic. Lid on, 40 seconds. And just give it a little pulse. Homemade pesto, done in about 40 seconds. I don't need to season it with salt because the Parmesan's got plenty of salt. Also, that story about the freezer being your best friend, it is. Now, if you freeze homemade pesto, that is gonna always be twice, at least twice as good as anything in a jar. Why? Because the freezer can trap all those perfumes. It really is very, very good. Let's just get a little freezer mold like that, fill it up. You can take like a little cube of frozen pesto and put it on garlic bread. You could put it on a chicken breast that you're roasting, or, you know, a lovely piece of grilled fish, salmon, anything like that. You know, you can take a couple of cubes and toss it with some lovely tagliatelle. So this is about having homemade delicious food work hard for you. So if you whack this in the freezer, here's one that I froze. Look, that's what you get. Homemade, fresh, and without question gonna be better than anything in a jar, right? Because it's frozen, not pasteurized. Okay, so that's a nice little hack that hopefully is getting you thinking. So the rest of this pesto, I'm just gonna put into this bowl. Once you make pesto that quickly, you'll never buy the jarred stuff again, I'm telling you. So look, homemade pesto in 40 seconds, and also a batch in the freezer for a rainy day to go on all kinds of different things. So back to the pan here, I can hear we're starting to get some serious frying. Can you hear that? Let's just talk about frozen vegetables. So I think there's a kind of idea out there that frozen veggies are down market, that are not as good, that they're sort of a lower quality. It's an interesting one. As far as nutrition is concerned, it's highly likely that frozen vegetables are more nutritious than fresh. How can frozen veg be more nutritious than fresh? Okay, let me explain. As soon as you pick something that's fresh, the graph of nutrition is starting to wane. Right, and if you're thinking about something that's taken a week to get into the supermarket or the market, it's just going down and down and down. It might look fresh, but the nutrition's depleting, right? As soon as veggies for freezing are picked, they're normally frozen within 8 hours, right? So it captures and it traps that nutrition. So from a nutrition point of view, frozen veggies are epic. From a waste point of view, they're epic, because I can go in and I can take a little handful and just put a bit more veg into a dish, and I can leave that in the freezer. So from a waste point of view, epic. Convenience, epic. So look, back to the soup. For fun, actually not for fun, for thoughtfulness, that rind of Parmesan, often that goes in the bin, right? So it's hard and it's salty. But what if I put it in here, right? So you can use that as a seasoning flavor bomb. So Parmesan has that umami flavor. It's also very salty on the skin. But when you put it in a soup, you shouldn't have to season much at all, right? And then interestingly, after some nice simmering, that hard, inedible Parmesan rind actually softens up. And then you can actually slice it up and then you can eat it. You can even sort of fry it and make it crispy. It's very, very cool. Now, I'm happy to add the next veggies. So I'm gonna go in now with just a load, no specific amount, of broad beans, peas. I'll go in with some broccoli here. I'm gonna go in with the chicken stock. Of course, you can use stock cubes and boiling water, but homemade chicken stock is always gonna be really, really delicious. So in we go, and it's all gonna start defrosting. This is gonna taste delicious in any soup, risotto, stew, curry. Like, it makes or breaks a dish. So in I go with 1.5 litres of lovely stock. So look, let that just melt down, bring it to a boil, and then I'll show you what to do next. So this has been simmering for about 15 minutes. Smells beautiful, thanks to that incredible chicken stock and that lovely base that we fried down. So look, you can see the color of the frozen veg is beautiful. So what I want to show you now is the pasta. This is frozen lasagna sheets. I'm just showing you this as a nice little hack. So what's great about this is, because it's fresh, when I got it, you can get it on bargain or reduced or whatever you want to call it, just put it in the freezer. It's really good. If you take it out of the freezer, they kind of defrost really quickly. You can use it for your lasagnas. Sometimes you have leftovers. So we're literally just going to break it all up badly, like that, big bits, small bits, and it doesn't take much time to cook at all. So that just goes in. You could, of course, use dried pasta. And for me, personally, when I do this kind of soup, I get all the odds and sods, the random bits, smash them all up and just throw them in there. I like having small bits and I like having some big bits. So just stir that through. So that is looking and smelling very, very good. Nearly ready to go. Of course it's fresh, so it only needs like 3-4 minutes to cook. So let's get a couple of little bowls here. Let's get our lovely homemade pesto. So look, it's coming up. We're pretty much there. A little extra salt and a little bit of black pepper. Stir that through, it's gonna be absolutely delicious. This is ready to serve, lovely people. Let's do it. A lovely bowl of hot steaming broth. Look, there is actually, let's pull that out. There's that Parmesan here. Let's just take that out. Chop that up and that'll just be a bomb of delicious seasoning and flavor that you can stir through there. So what I love to do is just finish that with a beautiful pesto. So there you go. Because you have to, a little bit of olive oil on the top, and that is a beautiful dish. I've got one last little freezer hack for you. It's one of my favorite ones, actually. When you buy fresh chilies, if you've got too many, it happens to me quite a lot, I'll just throw it into the freezer, right? And if you freeze a chili hard, you can just grab a grater and you can grate chili frozen over the top like this. Look at that. Can you see what it's doing? And once you've finished doing it, back in the freezer. Enough yapping. Time to get slurping. Get a bit of pasta, get a bit of pesto, a bit of broth. Mmm. Oh yeah. It makes me feel really, really happy. Just gorgeous. And look, I've celebrated all things frozen today, and I think it's really important to do that. You know, being passionate about food, being a chef, can't just be about farmers markets and growing. Like, it has to sort of look at the reality of life and convenience. And this is a really good one. And if you want to mix and match frozen with fresh asparagus in there, handful of spinach in there, of course, go for it. Swap out the pasta, go in with rice. Swap out the rice, go in with gnocchi. Swap out the gnocchi, go in with bread. Like you can just make this yours. But one thing is for sure, if you follow the little points of care in this recipe, you will be making some of the best soups of your life. Enjoy. This is my mobile pub, as you do. I'm gonna show you how to make a delicious sausage and squash chili con carne. Really simple to make, luscious to eat. The kids love it. You can do a big old batch of it as well. It's gonna be a beautiful thing. I've got the oven on. I've got a pan on here, a nice little casserole pan. So first up, get a nice squash. Now, the skin actually is very delicious, but what I love about peeling it is it kind of allows the squash to soak up all those beautiful flavors. So once you've peeled it, just take the end off the squash. Remember, the squash is round,
So obviously be careful when you're cutting it. And when it comes into slicing it like that, just like keep your hands out of the way and just gently angle it down like that. Don't put your weight on too much. Nothing kind of erratic. Then we've got these little seeds here. So I'm gonna grab a little spoon and we can remove these seeds. Now these seeds you can save, you can dry, and you can plant out next year to grow more pumpkin, which is very, very cool. So I'm using a butternut squash. You can use any squash or dense pumpkin that you like. Just slice it into little kind of sort of 1.5, 2 centimeter chunks. So I've got the butternut squash done, then it's the sausages. Look at that, 400 grams of beautiful sausages. Now what I wanna do is just add a little bit of oil and I wanna fry off these sausages. I wanna pull them out into little meatballs. Gonna get the sausage like that, pinch it with your hand like that, and it comes out like a rustic little ball. Very, very simple, straight in like that. The better the sausages, the better this dish will be. As soon as we got a little bit of color happening here, what we can do is add some nice fragrant things, right? We want to get some spice happening. So half a little cinnamon stick like this, just snap it. That'll go in, that'll start toasting up in all that frying fat. I'll season generously with black pepper, which I like. Then I'm gonna use two little spice hacks here. One is smoked paprika. The smoked paprika gives you that beautiful smoky flavor, like it's been cooked over a fire. Then I'm using a little Cajun spice. Now, these little kind of Cajun spices, jerk spices, ras al hanout, curry powders, these are quite genius, right? Because they're little blends. So there's about like 8 or 10 spices in here. Oreganos, all the peppers, you know, garlic and onion powder. So I'm gonna put two of these heaped teaspoons in. Just toast that onto those lovely sausage meatballs. Look at that. That's properly rustic. And then I'm gonna just highlight a little product that I kind of rate. You can use onion, carrot, and celery. So the Italians will call that a sofrito. And this is a frozen product. So if you go to the supermarket, you get bags of frozen carrots, celery, onions. It's just a nice little hack. I really like supporting the frozen veg. I think it's genius. It's brilliant for like just taking handfuls, two handfuls, not wasting stuff. I think for busy people that want to cook lovely food, these little cheats are amazing. You know, it's not just about frozen peas. I want to use like 2 or 3 cloves of garlic. That's how you're going to get that really deep, comforting flavor. Nice little trick, actually, using balsamic vinegar. This will give it a nice little kind of tang, and it'll give it the most delicious depth of flavor and a gorgeous color. Look at that. Also, it's like an amazing excuse to get more beans in, right? Because we expect to have beans in a chili con carne. So any beans you like, white beans, cannellini beans, bellotti beans, butter beans, black-eyed peas, kidney beans, even chickpeas. So I'm gonna use a little bit of rosemary in here. Rosemary's a great herb. So just a couple of sprigs, just finely chop that. Look at the colors, the orange and the green and all the kind of gnarly bits of sausage. Absolutely beautiful. Now we go in with the wet stuff in the form of lovely tinned tomatoes and some lovely kidney beans. Use any beans you want. I'm using kidney and black beans. Go in, juice and all. That little liquid is perfect for creating an amazing sauce. Then some lovely tomatoes, gonna make it sweet and delicious. And look, if you wanted to do a veggie version of this or a vegan version of this, that's fine, just pull out the meat. And I would sort of suggest using some fresh and dried mushrooms to get that umami, that depth of flavor. Give it a little season with salt and then pop it into the oven. Now, what's nice about popping it in the oven is it will continue to simmer and cook, so essentially stew, but from the top it's gonna bake or roast. So we call that braising, right? That means you're gonna get color on here. You're gonna get reduction of liquid, but concentration of flavor. It's gonna be amazing. So I'm very happy with that. Let's get that in the oven now. Normal oven, 180 degrees Celsius, 350 Fahrenheit, and then I'll show you what to do next. So it's had an hour and a half, and it's just been blipping away. Have a little look at that. I mean, it's a real picture. So you can see how it's reduced down. So I want to give you a little tip on extra deliciousness, okay? It's a good one, potato masher. So if you just go to one little side of the pan, just mash one side, right? So what's that doing? This is breaking up some of the sausage, some of the beans, and some of that lovely butternut squash, right? So just do it to about a third of this pan. And what does it do? It gives you a creaminess. and it gives you a real smash of deliciousness and sort of unctuous flavour. So once we've finished doing that, we fold it through with all the chunks again. So that, I believe, is how you get really incredible texture. Oh, that was so good. A little extra virgin olive oil, not as an oil, but as a kind of ingredient, right? And you get that lovely, grassy, fresh flavour, and it gives it the most wonderful sheen. And on the floor is my little dog, Conker. He's got very wet, he's chilling out, but he's very excited about this sausage chili con carne. A little bit of balsamic. I know we put some in already, but that's cooked away. But just a little thimble of vinegar, any vinegar, can often lift a ragu. That's beautiful. I'm gonna pop that back in the oven just for a little bit while I do the rice. We're gonna go in with some rice. I'm gonna fill this up twice. If you wanted to add some nice flavor, you know, you could take a little mixture of herbs, right, and just put that in there as well and get a lovely, lovely sort of fragrance and flavor to it. So this goes in and we'll boil that for 12 minutes. By that time, everything's gonna be perfect. Let's have a little look at this rice. It's had about 12 minutes. It goes from boiling and then that noise stops. And that's when you normally know it's just lightly frying. So that's a good sign. So then we can take out the herb. That's the brilliant thing about herb, man. They've done their job. Can you see how light and fluffy that is? Every time, a winner. So I like that method. Smells amazing. Let's just portion up a little bit. I love rice. You can see the little flecks of herb in there. Let's get our lovely chili out. Look at these beautiful chunks. So, chili con carne, but not as you know it. And then for me, just a lovely little bit of yogurt in there. Some pepper and just a little olive oil. You can finish that with a little soft herb like coriander if you want. For me, that is beautiful comfort food for this time of year when the weather's closing in. You get epic flavor in there and texture. Mmm. Mmm. It's delicious. Sausage chili con carne. Super simple. Like, get it all going. You can double the recipe, you can triple it. It's not like spicy chili spicy. Like, my little 7-year-old would have no trouble with that at all. It's very mild, it's very layered. There's lots of nice little surprises, but this is delicious. I'm gonna show you how to make the most delicious crumble pie. It's not quite a pie or a crumble, it's both. And I'm gonna serve that with vanilla ice cream and it's gonna be delicious. Let's start with some tinned pears. They're really, really good. They're picked at their best. They're processed really proficiently. They're beautifully trimmed up and peeled. They've done all the hard work for you. So what I'm gonna do is get a nice little casserole pot, put it on a medium-high heat. I'm gonna put my hands over the pear and just pour in that liquor. So that's just pure juice. So what we can do is just bring this to the boil and reduce it and get it down to a syrup, which will be a natural sugar syrup. Now, frozen fruit. I've got two bags of Black Forest mix. So in here, we've got the sour cherries, blackberries, sweet cherries, even blueberries and blackcurrants. Brilliant. If you look in here, can you see the bubbles have come up already? If we reduce that by half, we're gonna concentrate those natural sugars and it will give you a kind of syrup, which is really, really nice. Now, I wanna get some flavor in there. I'm gonna use some vanilla. So 1 teaspoon of vanilla paste. Now, one of the flavors that I'm using is orange and you don't always have to use the juice. The zest is amazing. So what I do is I use one of these fine graters, or if you've got a box grater, use the little fine side. And I just wanna use like a quarter of an orange, just like that. And that little bit of zest is more than enough to really lift this whole story. So, you can see this syrup has already thickened. Can you see that? And so now in with those quarters of pear, and then in with this pack of frozen fruit. So that's 2 500-gram bags. I'm gonna go in with 150 grams of sugar. You could swap out the sugar for honey. I'd go slightly less, maybe 100 grams, because it's a little bit sweeter by weight. So mix in that sugar. And we'll cook that down on like a medium heat
for 5 minutes just to mix all those beautiful flavours up. And that is the perfect amount of time for making homemade pastry. It's really simple. If you've never done it before, come with me on this little journey. So, clean hands. I've got 200 grams of butter, beautiful unsalted butter. I'm just going to put a cloth down there because it's wobbling. What I want to do is add twice the amount of flour by weight. So 200 butter, 400 plain flour. Okay, and that is the ratio that gives you perfection every single time. Salt it for seasoning. I'm also going to put a little orange zest in it as well. So maybe half of an orange zest goes in. Will it make a difference? Yes. But also a little icing sugar. So 75 grams of icing sugar as well goes in. And then we're going to use our fingers and thumbs to just basically squash this butter and just rub it in like that. So use your thumb and forefinger to just pinch and push the butter into little flakes. It's a nice little relaxing job just to do for a few minutes while the fruit does its thing. Look at those colors. But look, one of the problems with fruit-based desserts is they can let off too much liquid and become a little bit, watery, I guess. So we can control that in two ways. One, by cooking it down a little bit, as we are. Have a little look at this. So we're evaporating off some of that excess liquid. The other way, which is brilliant, is to use 30 grams or 2 heaped tablespoons of corn flour. It's going to thicken this up, and when your tart, once it's cooked, gets to room temperature, it kind of just solidifies a little bit, and then it will control that liquidiness. So let that simmer for just a couple of minutes while I'll finish this pastry. We'll take just a handful of this topping. So make a little well in the middle. Then I'm going to add into here one lovely large free-range egg, and then I'm going to use this second egg in two ways. The first way, I'm going to put the egg whites in here. That is just to glaze the side of the beautiful tart shell. And then this yolk will go in here. So it's one egg, one yolk. And then I'm just going to use my hand now just to mix it up, and it will come together to make a lovely pastry. So you want it to kind of come together as a dough by kind of moving, sort of scrunching and patting it together. Why? Because we want it to be short. Short means crumbly. Crumbly means delicate. Delicate means delicious, right? So the more you work it, the harder it will get. So in no time at all, look what we got. Some lovely homemade pastry and our lovely crumbly topping. This will go in the fridge now for half an hour, just to chill out, firm up. Then I've got a great little hack on how you can line a pastry mold really easily. And then look, have a look at this. This is thickened up beautifully. So I'll turn the heat off, let that cool down. So I'll come back in half an hour and let's make this beautiful crumble pie. So we've had a little time to cool down the filling and chill out the pastry. Look, normally with pastry, you would roll it out. There are some techniques where you slice it and then kind of push it together. This one is a slightly different method. Your hard, firmed up pastry, I'm just gonna grate it just like cheddar cheese, right, on the coarse grater. And all that worry about, are you doing it perfectly, have gone, because it's a very rustic sort of base. Any worries about tears or cuts? Well, that's not a problem because the whole thing is just gonna get sort of pushed like that together. So, grate away. I want it to be about half a centimetre thick, pushing this in to be one homogeneous little layer. So I'll grate some now on the side to actually push up the sides. So, have a little look. Just grab a little wodge and just squeeze it and push it. What I like about this method is if you do it really well, that's great. And if you do it quite badly, it's great. And if it gets more people to try and make their own pastries and desserts, I think that's a really good thing. So, last bit's going in. Run your fingers around, but that's basically it. Now, we're not gonna bake this blind, so that's kind of one stage that you don't have to do for a normal tart. What I'm gonna do is get this cooled filling, and I'm gonna put that inside. Look at the color, just extraordinary. Look at that, so get your juice in there. With this crumble topping, just kind of grab some and just kind of scrunch it up a little bit and then kind of break it into those nice crumbly chunks. Having the crumble topping just lets it breathe a little bit and it starts to blip away and it's just joyful. Look at that, gorgeous. So the only thing I'm gonna do now is just take a little bit of that egg white and just run the brush
around that, just so you get a nice kind of shine to it. So this is going to go in the oven now for 45 minutes. And I'm going to specifically put it at the bottom of the oven. Why? So we get maximum heat to the base of this tart mold. So we get crispy bum, crispy side, and perfectly cooked tart. In an oven which has been set to 180 degrees Celsius, which is 350 Fahrenheit, that heat from the bottom of the oven will cook the base of the pastry case, the sides, the fruit will start blipping away, the crumble will be golden. It's going to be a thing of joy with a nice dollop of vanilla ice cream. So, it's had 45 minutes. It smells amazing. It looks beautiful. Look at that. Oh, just blipping away. It's like fruity lava with that crumble topping. If you let this cool down for like 2 hours to come to room temperature, it will just firm up and it will slice beautifully. And even if you want to put it in the fridge as well, it will firm up even more. So I'll let that cool down and then I'll serve that with a nice bit of vanilla ice cream and it will be a beautiful thing. Okay, so you can see now it's cooled down. It's kind of just shrinked up a little bit. It looks beautiful. You can see by grating the pastry, you do get a different texture. So let's get in there. As usual, sharp knife. You can kind of try and support the side so it doesn't break too much. It doesn't matter if it does. Look at that. Oh. Welcome to the wonderful world of a crumble pie. And that on a plate with a nice little dollop of ice cream. Let's have a try. Exciting. Mmm. Making your own pastry makes such a difference to the texture. It's shorter, it's crumblier. Just such a joy. Guys, please make this. If you've never made pastry, have a go. So simple. And that method gives you such a wonderful, rustic finish and delicious to eat. Enjoy. Take care.